Before we study the general state of stress, let's take a simple case of a bar subjected to axial load like this. Okay, so let it be subjected to a load P, and let this cross section of be A. Now, if you want to find the stress that is axial stress, you can find out sigma is equal to P by A. Now, here is an important point. So, at this point, I have taken an area which is perpendicular to the applied load. Suppose if I take another area, okay, like this, at the same point, but the area is now inclined. As you can see from this figure, this area A dash is bigger. So, when you calculate stress at this point, let me say sigma dash, you will get P by A dash. Now, as you can see from this diagram, so A dash is bigger than A because it is inclined area. From here to here is A dash, from here to here is A. So, because A dash is bigger, the sigma dash will be smaller. So, as you can see from here, as I keep on rotating this area, the stress keeps on decreasing. And again, when I rotate here, again, it keeps on increasing and becomes maximum here. So, stress at a point is dependent not only on the applied load, it also depends on the inclination of the cross section that we are considering. Therefore, we say stress is a tensor quantity because it has got one magnitude and two directions, because this load P also has got a direction and area has also got a direction, and together P by A is a magnitude. So, one magnitude, two directions. Of course, area is the magnitude in the sense the distance from here to here is its magnitude and direction is perpendicular to this. Okay, basically it's an inclination of the area. So, therefore, technically speaking, if you want to find the stress at any point, you should calculate all the stresses possible by orienting the area in different possible directions. So, it is one, whatever you have seen just now is a orientation in one particular plane, let us say XY plane. Suppose it is also possible to orient this area in other two planes also. So, technically speaking, you can orient this area in infinite number of directions, infinite number of orientations. So, and therefore, the different stresses that you can calculate are also infinite. So, if you want to really mention a stress at a point completely, you should be mentioning all possible stresses at this point. So, like technically, it's like infinite number of stresses at a point or stress components at a point. But fortunately, it is not required. So, you can show it later that at a point, if you know just six stress components, okay, as shown at this point, this is a point of interest here, okay, and if you take six planes, and on these six planes, if you know the stresses acting, then you can find out stress on any other plane that you desire. So, therefore, to correctly specify a stress at a point, you need to know at least six components as shown in this diagram. So, sigma xx, sigma yy, sigma zz, and tau xy, tau yz, and tau zx. Of course, you can see that by equilibrium, the sigma yx is same as sigma xy. So, this guy is trying to rotate like this, and this guy is trying to rotate like this. They balance each other because we are assuming that the body is under equilibrium. So, therefore, we need totally six components of stresses to completely specify the state of stress at a point. So, knowing the six, you can find out stress on any other inclined plane that you want. Now, we will just quickly review how to find out the stress components. Suppose, if it is a beam or an axial bar subjected to an axial load, say P, and cross-section area is A, then you can find out normal stress as P by A. So, that is when you have axial load. Second case is, suppose you have, say, bending moment. Okay, this is a beam and it is subjected to some bending moment M. So, somewhere this is neutral axis, somewhere here I want to find out the stress value. Let this be at a distance of Y, and this cross-section area, let it have a moment of inertia I. So, you can find out the bending stress as sigma is equal to My by I. Of course, these stresses are compressive at the top layer and they are tensor at the bottom layer. So, you can find out the stresses from the loads. This is axial load and this is bending load. And of course, if there is a torsion also, let's say we have a torsion, something like this. So, when there is a torque acting, then also somewhere here, I want to find out its stress, I can use the formula tau is equal to TR by IP. So this axial load and bending moment are producing what are known as normal stresses, whereas this torque is producing shear stresses. So knowing the loads, the P, M and tau and other geometric factors, you'll be able to find out the stresses. So once you know the stresses, you can find out what are the stresses acting on this element. As we discussed already, in case of a uniaxial loading, so if you take the area perpendicular, you have one value of stress. If you take another area, you will have another value of stress. If you take another area, you will have another value of stress. So the stress keeps on varying depending on the area of you consider. That means it depends on the inclination of the area you consider. So when you keep on rotating, you will find some planes where the shear stresses are zero. So in general, if you take a cross section area, any area, so there can be a normal force, there can be a shear force tau and sigma. So those planes where the shear stresses are zero are called principal planes. Principal planes are the planes where shear stresses are zero, and the normal stresses acting on these principal planes are called principal stresses. They are denoted by sigma 1, sigma 2 and sigma 3. So these are also known as extremum values. That means these are the maximum or minimum values at a point. So there will be three principal stresses at a given point. However, you have to remember, so there are two ways of representing stress at a point. Either you can represent all the six component, or you can represent only three principal stresses. So both are same. They both represent the stress at a particular point. So either you can represent six stresses acting along a particular coordinate axis, or you can represent three principal planes in principal stresses in principal coordinate system. So these two can be used to represent the stress at a point completely. Now, if there is a situation where all the components of our loads are acting or stresses are acting, let's say there is a cubical element, and as shown in the previous diagram, all the sigma x is acting along x axis, there is a stress, along y axis there is a stress, along z axis also there is a stress. Now on these planes also you will find shear stresses given by tau xy, tau yz and tau zx. So in general, there can be totally six stress components acting at a point. If that is the case, now how to find the principal stresses? Principal stresses are the stresses acting on the principal planes, and principal planes are those planes where shear stresses are zero. So therefore, on principal planes you will find there are no shear stresses, and stress at a point is completely determined by only three normal stresses, which are nothing but principal stresses. In general, if the stresses are all the components of stresses are acting, then you can find out the principal stresses by using this cubic equation. So usually these equations are used in PG only. In for UG students, this may not be useful at this point of time, but let's finish and understand for the sake of continuity. So where I1, I2, I3 are called stress invariants. Okay, they are given by this formula. So I1 is this, I2 and I3. So given sigma x, sigma y and sigma z, tau xy, tau yz and tau z, you will be able to find out the I1, I2, I3. And this I1, I2, I3 are substituted in this equation, and then the sigma is solved. Once you solve the sigma, because it is a cubic equation, you will get three values. And these three values are sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3. So these are called principal stresses. So that is the most general case where all the stress components are acting. But most of the times you will not be using this. So our focus will be on the 2D state of stress. 2D state of stress means it's again a cubical element. I'll draw a cubical element here. And you may have sigma x. Sigma x is acting on this. Sigma y is acting on this. And this shear stress, tau xy and tau yx are acting in this. So the stress on the other face here, it is not there. The stress on the z face is zero. So when such situation exists, we will say the body is under 2D state of stress. So all the stresses are confined to single plane. In this case, the stresses are in the xy plane, are confined to xy plane. So if I say xy plane, you have got sigma x, sigma y, and tau xy. Of course, tau yx is same as tau xy only. So this is known as the 2D state of stress. So most of the engineering problems are 2D in nature, and so we'll focus mostly on this particular state of stress. Please remember, in the diagram, a 2D diagram, we are shown in this fashion. It doesn't mean it's a thin plate. It's basically a cubic element only. Only thing you are seeing from this direction, you will see sigma x, sigma y, and tau xy as shown in this diagram. So please keep in mind, this is actually a 3D diagram, but seen from the front view. Now, when we actually try to solve an equation to find out the principal stresses, one important conclusion can be arrived from this. What is that important conclusion? In general, we said we have three principal stresses for a 3D case. So if it is 3D, we have got three principal stresses. But for 2D, you will find only two principal stresses, and another principal stress is third principal stress will be zero. That is sigma 3 will be zero. So these principal stresses are in planar. So if x, y is your plane of interest, so you will have, if this is sigma x and this is your sigma y, so within the plane, somewhere here you may find sigma 1, somewhere here you may find sigma 2. So these two are the principal stresses. The third principal stress, even though we are saying it is the third principal stress, sigma 3 will always be 0. So the principal stress perpendicular to these two principal stresses, that is sigma 1 and sigma 2, is always 0. So once we know the third principal stress is zero, now our interest is only to find out what are these two principal stresses, sigma 1 and sigma 2. I would like to use the notation sigma A and sigma B for these two principal stresses. The equations for this in planar principal stresses sigma A and sigma B are as shown. So there's an important equation. So please remember, even though it is 2D, the actual stress condition is 3D in nature. So the nature doesn't differentiate between 1D, 2D or 3D. It is always 3D. Only for our convenience, we are making it as 2D. So we are saying 2D because the third component is anyway 0. So our interest is to find only sigma A and sigma B. Now, as I said, in case of 2D, we have only sigma X, sigma Y and tau XY. Okay. So when you substitute here sigma X, sigma Y and tau XY, you will get two values. So those two values are given by this equation, sigma A and sigma B. Sorry, it should have been sigma B. Let me make the correction. This is sigma B. So only difference is there is a plus sign here, there is a minus sign here. So two in planar stress and one out of plane principal stress, which is equal to zero. So let's see some special cases. So it's even in 2D also. So when we say a 2D, we have sigma x, sigma y, and tau xy. In some cases, it may so happen that the shear stress is only existing, and one normal stress is existing. So let's say sigma x is existing and tau xy is existing, and sigma y is zero. If that is the case, then the above equations can be simplified in this fashion. So instead of here, we had sigma x plus sigma y by 2, by all divided by 2, but because sigma y is 0, you can directly write it sigma x by 2. So these things will be used in solving the problems. Third component is anyway 0. This is the first case. Okay. And second case is biaxial loading. Biaxial loading means shear is 0. The shear stress is 0. Only two uniaxial stresses, sigma x and sigma y, are acting. So when that is the case, the things become a little simpler. The sigma x acting itself will become the first principal stress, and the sigma y acting applied stress itself will become principal stress. So if you know applied stress, that itself is the principal stress. And of course, third principal stress is anyway zero, irrespective of what you are applying. That is the case of biaxial stress. Now let's go to the case of pure shear. Pure shear means only shear stress exists. So if you take an element like this, sigma x is not there, sigma y is not there, only you have got a shear. okay, only tau xy is acting. That is the case, we will find a very strange thing here, that out of the two in-planar principal stresses sigma and sigma b, the magnitude of those two principal stresses will be same, one will be tau xy, another will also be tau xy, except that the second one will have a negative sign, so it will be acting in opposite direction, and the third anyway is zero. Now we will get into an important concept called finding the maximum shear stress. So stress at any point, as I said, is given by 6 components. So when you rotate the stress element in 360 degree, so we will find 3 planes where shear stress is 0. And these planes, we call them as principal planes, and the normal stress acting them as principal stresses, sigma 1, sigma 2 and sigma 3. That was a general case. Now, we can also show that these normal stresses which are acting on the principal planes are also the maximum or minimum stresses. So among these three, one will be maximum, one will be minimum, and other one will be in between these two values. So these are also called as extremum values. Similarly, can we have a shear stress becoming maximum and minimum? Yes, it is possible. So when you rotate a stress element by 360 degree, there will be three locations or three orientations at which the shear stress will be either maximum or minimum. So what we call it as extremums. Extremums are, so when you rotate this element, that is a cubical element 360 degree, you will find the three planes where the shear stresses are maximum. Okay, and there are formulas to find out those shear stresses. So three shear stresses can be found out using the applied stress sigma x, sigma y and sigma z and other three components. But generally it is a tradition to express the maximum value of shear stress in terms of the principal stresses that we have already found out. So that is the formula for that is given in this equation. So once you know sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3, these are the three principal normal stresses. From these you can find out three shear stresses called tau 1, tau 2 and tau 3. So these are all local extremums. Among these three, you will find one will be maximum, another one will be minimum, and the third one will be in between this. Now which one will become maximum and which one will become minimum cannot be guessed in advance. Only by substituting in the equation and find based on the value of sigma x, sigma y, it will decide which one is maximum and which one is minimum. So you cannot say that always tau 1 is a maximum. It is not possible. Only numericals when substituted will give you the values which one is maximum. So it is not possible to say which shear stress is maximum in advance. Of course, these are all local maximums. Among these three, there will be one maximum, one minimum, and other one will be in between these. So finally, we have expressed shear stress in terms of principal stresses. So as I said already, so you will get three values of shear stresses, and among these three, you have to choose the numerically maximum as the maximum shear stress. Okay. So that's how we will find out maximum shear stress. So first, what you have to do, the rule is from sigma x, sigma y and sigma z, so you will find out principal stresses sigma 1, sigma 2 and of course sigma 3 is 0. Okay, from principal stresses you can find out tau 1, tau 2 and tau 3. From these tau 1, tau 2, tau 3, one of them will be the maximum, that will be known as tau max. Okay, so that's how we find maximum shear stress. Now in case of 3D case, that is general 3D case, you have got all the 6 components and therefore all the principal stresses will be existing. So if at all if we make a convention just for our own convenience, that we will always arrange sigma 1 to be the maximum stress and sigma 3 to be the minimum stress and sigma 2 in between. So if that is the case, you don't have to do this calculation, like you don't have to calculate sigma 2, sigma 3, sigma 3, sigma 1 and sigma 1 minus sigma 2. So you can directly avoid this. All you have to do is simply arrange the principal stresses in the decreasing order and then you take the first and last, you can directly get the tau max. So this will save our time. That is for general 3D case. Now what happens in case of 2D? 2D is case is very interesting. Okay, let's take the case where let sigma A, sigma B, the two in-planar principal stresses. Okay, from the formula that we have seen earlier, you can find out sigma A and sigma B. These are principal stresses only. But the point is, because there is a third principal stress which is equal to zero, we cannot tell whether the sigma is maximum or sigma B is minimum or zero is maximum or zero is minimum. So only way is you have to arrange them, and then accordingly can find out. Let us say, for example, in a problem I solved for sigma 1 and sigma 2, and I found the value of sigma A. Okay, the first one is minus 20, second one is minus 30. Now when I arrange it, I should be careful enough to see that the third component, that is sigma C, is anyway 0. So if you arrange, then that will become 0 is greater than minus 20 is greater than minus 30. So this is how I should arrange. So just because 0 is there, it should not be neglected. So in this case, the sigma 1, the maximum value of normal stress is sigma. Sigma 1 is 0, and the minimum value of normal stress is minus 30. So therefore, if you want to use this equation, sigma 1 minus 3, you will get 0 minus of minus 30 by 2 will give the maximum shear stress. So it's important to remember that you should not forget the third component of principal stress, that is out of plane principal stress. Now let us study the case of state of stress during loading in a UTM test. Because most of the theories of failure that we study have got a statement where we will be using the value of stress at the point of failure in a UTM test. So in UTM test, what we do is we have a specimen, you apply a load like this. Usually we do a uniaxial test, we apply sigma y and sigma y. And other stresses are not there. So you are not applying any stress along x-axis and z-axis. Only sigma y is there. So, and the sigma y is found out by knowing the applied force divided by the area. And the sigma x, sigma z is 0, and tau x y, tau z is also, other three are also 0. So only stress that exists in case of UTM test or simple tensor test is sigma y. That is given by the formula FIA. So if you are doing the other test, that is compressive stress, only the direction of force will change. Okay, otherwise everything remains same. So then also you can find out the y component of stress as FIA, and other components are 0. So the sigma x, sigma z, and all shear stresses are 0 because you are not applying them basically. So only force you are applying is sigma y. Therefore you will find only force you are applying is in the y direction. So you will get only normal stress in the y direction. Now let us see what happens at the time of failure. So when it's about to fail, you will find the sigma y is reaching its maximum. Now, though the sigma y is reaching its maximum value, which we say is yield point stress, and of course sigma x and sigma z are anyway 0. Okay, so now let us look at the value of principal stresses. So this is the equation for in planar principal stress, sigma a comma b. So you got this general equations. Now, as we said, sigma x is 0, so we'll substitute 0 for this case. Sigma y is your ultimate tensile stress or yield point, depending on which case you are using it. So if it is a ductile material, we'll be using yield point for this location. If it is a brittle material, we'll be using ultimate tensile stress. Okay. So when you substitute here, 0, and then this also 0, you'll get this, and finally you will find this. So therefore, one of the principal planes is equal to sigma ut. And second in planar principal stress is equal to 0 at the time of failure. So what I'm trying to say is, when a test is done, simple tensile test is done, so one of the principal stress will be ultimate tensile stress or yield point stress, depending on which material you use. And other component, that is second principal stress, will be 0, and third principal stress is anyway 0. That sigma c is anyway 0, that we already seen. So in case of UTM test, the only applied load is sigma y, and the only principal stress that exists is sigma a is equal to sigma ut or sigma up. That is, at the time of failure, the maximum principal stress is either sigma yp, that is yield point stress, or sigma ut, that is ultimate tensile stress or compressive stress. So there, in this table, we have summarized. So in general, a body can have three components of stress: sigma 1, sigma 2, and sigma 3. Now, in case of tensile test, we have shown just now that only sigma ut exists or sigma yield point exists. So the first principal stress is always equal to yield point stress or ultimate tensile stress, and second component of principal stress is zero, and third component of principal stress is also zero. So this is the condition of stress at the point of failure. So to summarize, let me say, so in case of UTM test or tensile test, so point number one, I am applying only sigma y. So I could have applied sigma x, sigma y, sigma z. So there are xy, yz, zx. Of these, only I am applying sigma y. Okay. And so when you apply stresses, you will have principal planes, principal stresses. So I can have sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3. So if you are applying all the six components, you will have all the three principal planes. Now in UTM, what is happening is we are not applying any of these components except sigma y. So therefore, you will find only one component of sigma 1 exists in UTM test and other two are zero. And then at the time of failure, the sigma 1 value will be equal to the sigma yield point or sigma ultimate tensile stress or compressive stress. So that's a summary of this discussion. So only one applied load, one principal stress, and that is equal to the material property known as sigma yield point and sigma ut.